the people of most countries in the world, not just New Zealand, don't realise how important the international rule of law is relating to trade, and it comes out first and foremost from the WTO. So, no, I think you're right. I don't think people realise how serious it is. We're not over the precipice yet, but we're getting closer by the day.
Trade Minister David Parker speaking to me earlier. Political scientist Professor Jennifer Curtin joins us now, along with the rest of the panel, Marianne Elliot, human rights lawyer, co-director of the workshop, a policy think tank, and Sir Lockwood Smith, former High Commissioner to the UK, and of course, a former National Trade Minister. Welcome to you all again. Sir Lockwood, it is worrying out there, isn't it? And do you think this government is doing what it can possibly do?
I think what Minister Parker said made a lot of sense. You know, he's right that the WTO is so important to New Zealand. One of the great things about the appellate system or the judicial system there is you can take your mates to the WTO, win,
and still be mates.
We took Australia there over apples. We took the United States to the WTO over lamb tariffs in the late 90s and won. And yet we remained very good mates because they understood those are the rules. And in fact, sometimes they quite like you taking them to the WTO because it overcomes a political problem. In the case of the lamb tariffs in the United States, they didn't want to have to impose them. Their system sort of required them to, and they were quite pleased when the WTO ruled them, you know, illegal. So that for countries like New Zealand, it is so important. And David Parker's correct that the WTO in so many ways hasn't been working as well as it should. And if we are to preserve it, which we must, we do have to work with the US. There's no use saying the US is all wrong on this stuff because they are right on some of the issues.
Yeah, but they're causing a heck of a lot of trouble as well in the trade environment. And Marianne, I wonder whether, is it time for New Zealand to push back a bit more, be a bit more vocal, or do you think we've got to just keep our head down here?
To be honest, I really can't see how pushing back and making a lot more noise in the context that the minister's in is going to help. I'm just really taken by the question that you asked about, like, do the people of New Zealand understand how serious this is? And I think the minister recognised that. No, I don't think they do, but it's a very challenging one. I mean, does the government really want to sort of alarm people? You know, he's using words like just, you know, we're not at the precipice yet, but we're near to it. That's not really a frame that you want to be presenting to the public unless you've got some sort of sense of where the solution's going to come from.
So it does foreshadow that this government has got some seriously big challenges coming at it. It's survived a first year, it's looking reasonably solid, but it's got some big economic challenges, and trade has got to be one of the big ones, Jennifer.
Well, they'll be happy that five of the six countries needed to trigger the CPTTP, you know, that one.
Something like that.
Always get it wrong. So they've only got Australia left, really. So hopefully they'll come on board if this is what we need. I think what it sounded like with Minister Parker is that he's doing some brokering almost. He's having conversations with the White House about, you tell us what needs to change inside the WTO, and I'll take that information with me to the big meeting we're having in Ottawa, and we'll see if we can reconcile some of your concerns with the concerns we have. And maybe that's the sort of role, that sort of more brokerage role that we need to be playing, because we're small and we're not threatening. And we've seen New Zealand do that in a range of international areas. You know, Clark did it with torture protocols and so on. We're not a threatening country, and maybe we can be that intermediary to see some reform in WTO.
What about then on Saudi Arabia, Marianne? I mean, he didn't seem too keen to go much further than a strong statement on that issue.
No, and he made that distinction, didn't he, between, you know, countries that might be considering, you know, sanctions in terms of arms trade, which obviously has a very particular kind of place in the trade world compared to food and the impact it might have on poor people. It's a difficult one. I've for a very, very long time been uncomfortable with New Zealand's trading relationships with Saudi Arabia because of my human rights, you know, research and background, and it's not something I'm comfortable with, but he did try to make that distinction between perhaps if we were engaged more in something other than food, that We might be able to do something.
What do you think, Sir Lockwood? I mean, it is a tricky one. We're a trading nation.
And we trade with countries around the world that don't have our human rights approach. Countries where some of their human rights, you know, attitudes are totally abhorrent to us. And by working with them, actually, we possibly have more influence on them over time.
Do you think
but I think,
so?
I'm a great believer in that. You know, that there are times when you do have to draw the line, but other times, by getting more involved, we have a little bit of influence with China.
We drew the line with Russia, though, right? On the, we were going to do a free trade deal with Russia, and all of a sudden that was off the table.
But the world did. You know, the world did, and New Zealand became part of that global effort. To me, one of the pluses that's worth thinking about as we look at the WTO's future is Britain leaving the EU. Now, they want to become a global leader in trade. That's their aspiration. They're the fifth biggest economy in the world. They could help us if they can leave.
We'll be lucky to get the same rights we've already got. I mean, for beef and lamb and that sort of stuff.
No, but set that aside for the moment, because I think over time we'll sort that. But the chance to get the fifth biggest economy in the world really working with us on trying to reset the agenda at the WTO
right.
could be hugely valuable. And New Zealand has got, I mean, we started TPP or CPTPP. We started that.
So we got some creed.
And we've at the WTO, we've chaired the Agriculture Committee there for 20 years. Continuously.
Okay.
We've got a lot of influence there.
Let's just look at the issue of abortion. I mean, it's a tricky debate. There is going to be quite a lot of heat in it. What did you think of that debate? I mean, it's going to be difficult, isn't it?
Yes, but I think the Law Commission report is really solid piece of work. I mean, it's 300 pages, but they've really canvassed, in addition to the three models that they've outlined, they're really clear that it needs to come out of the Crimes Act. And they're really clear that women need safe access to clinics and that they should have access to their own health practitioners to get advice from. So there are a range of models that they're looking at, but I think the report itself is really solid basis. And I would just also like to say that we know from the New Zealand election study of 2017, which was taken after Jacinda Ardern had put this out there as an issue, that around 70% of Labor voters, 65% of National voters, and around 58% of New Zealand First voters all disagree with the statement that abortion is always wrong. Now, that's a very blatant, I mean, a very non-nuanced kind of way of asking a question, but it does suggest that there are a solid percentage of people out there who do not agree with abortion being prohibited.
That will give Andrew Little and the government some confidence to push this forward. Conscience votes can get tricky because people will lobby MPs. MPs come under pressure. Some MPs waver. I'm just thinking this could be a pretty defining conscience vote. We might have a couple of them, but it has to be pretty significant.
I imagine it will be. I hope very much that it's not a particularly hot political debate. I think it's an issue that, you know, as Jennifer said earlier, the time for this has come. The time for this to come out of the Crimes Act and for women to be able to,
Family First and these groups are very organised. They will protest pretty strong. They've already been taking protests to Parliament. I think it's going to be heated, isn't it?
Well, I mean, politicians and the media can choose how they respond to those kind of organisations and how we frame it. I mean, I think that we heard Alison as a practitioner talk in very sort of calm and not heated ways about the importance of women being able to access, you know, medical advice from their own medical practitioners and make the decisions that are right for them. And is there a lot of emotion in it? There is. I mean, I'm 46 years old, I'm a woman in this country. Between myself and my friends, you know, people have been through every possible kind of scenario around this. So of course there are strong feelings, but I think that we could call up in ourselves the
Let's
ability
so.
To have this conversation in a...
Let's hope so. Yeah. So, you would have seen plenty of conscience votes in your time. For individual MPs it can be difficult because they get lobbied very specifically, don't they?
Especially hard for newer members of parliament representing electorates where the electorate may have a strong view. And this issue, I mean, it never came up in my 29 years in parliament. And possibly people hold the strongest, most entrenched positions on this issue. But let's hope. Let's really hope that it's, as Jennifer said, a very good Law Commission report. It's timely that it comes up again. I mean, we've heard how long it is since some of these positions were put into the law. And I would like to think Parliament is mature enough to approach it in a sensible, rational way.
Let's hope so.